Thank you very much, Dr. Rawal, for very kind words about me. After having heard a lot of lectures, I know you people are very tired, and I'm going to hold you from lunch for a while. But let me tell you, my job here is going to be to rejuvenate you with some very useful chemistry related to corrosion work. I come from University of Delhi, and our department is the largest in the country. When I tell you the number, probably it will be a very mind-boggling thing for you. With 578 MSc students, our routine classes are as big as the audience right now is here. But we don't use mic, let me tell you. So it will tell in volumes about the way we speak. With about 400 research students, we on an average publish about 450 good high-impact research papers. And there are about 150 postdoctoral students. 40% of our faculty is always abroad at any point of time in the year. And our total semester strength of the faculty is 73, with about 53 present at the moment. Well, I am going to talk about corrosion in daily life, as I put the title very aptly. You will find it. And let me begin with a word of thanks to Charotar Education Society, Anand, and to my friend Dr. Rawal, and the organizer, Dr. Neeraj, who has been kind enough to invite me here. Well, the purpose of this talk are twofold. When I learned about the title of the conference, it was institutional and industrial building. My idea is going to be twofold. One, to after you hear my talk, you will be able to save about 30% of the annual maintenance that you are spending in your whatever you are doing, in your house, in your vehicle, for your adjoining maintenance, for your society. 30% is a large saving, and it will be a direct saving. And by a word of mouth, you can imagine how much you will be able to save in all. Second part is to inculcate my young friends into this area. Anybody you hear would always tell you, look, my area of research is extremely difficult, you cannot get into this. But I am going to say that my area where I have been working for the last so many years is very easy to work on, and wherever you are, whatever you are doing, even if you are in one of the remotest parts of the places, you will be able to carry out excellent research in this area. That's my ultimate goal. When I started working here, we had only two groups in the country, and now there are about 80 groups in the country. You get large number of projects in all the funding agencies in this. So that's the ultimate which one achieves. You need not bother about it. Corrosion is a very important area. You have all seen. Don't bother about what is written here. If you can read good enough, otherwise whatever I am speaking is what is going to be important. It's a very important area. You have seen all over. Wherever you see a brown patch, that's corrosion. You can see on the fan, you can see on the wall, you can see on the sanitary fittings in your houses, bridges, everywhere you have noted in your vehicle. So what is it? Sometimes we start wondering what is it, and we don't bother about it. Then, when you ask some of the celebrated engineers, they will tell you something basic about it, but they will not be able to answer in a very correct manner what is it. Even when I ask some of the IT engineers that what is it, they are not able to answer. They start giving you all kinds of long stories, which one doesn't like to hear. Simple thing like an aluminium strip that runs around the vehicle, why is it there, or what is it, why do they put it, they will not answer. They will just say it is for the aesthetic sense. It beautifies the vehicle, whereas it is not. In due course, I will be able to tell you what is the purpose of this. So, when I ask any engineer, do you have any problem about corrosion? You visit any plant, any factory? His answer will be, no, I have no problem. When something corrodes, we just replace that part, put a fresh one. I said, what do you do with that? We dump it in the open yard. I said, what happens after that? Well, we keep on dumping all the corroded parts there. Ultimately, what happens? Somebody comes, either a truck or when it is too much, we put it in a rail wagon and drive it away to some other place where we dump it. Then we reclaim that land without realizing that what one is doing is not the remedial part of corrosion, they are creating environmental hazard. So this is not what one has to do, and that's not what an engineer should be answering, that I have no problem of corrosion. Rather than using remedial measures, or rather than using methods which will lengthen the life of that article, says, well, one doesn't have any corrosion problem. That's very unfortunate. Now, what is it? You know, when you read literature, you will find a lot of definitions. But I have found a very simple definition, that is, it is any unwanted decay is defined as corrosion. Any unwanted decay. I don't want my skin to decay, that is also corrosion. Everything corrodes. Particularly, I mean, you would have heard about metal, but I am saying, I am generalizing, everything corrodes. This wood, paper, sheet, car, whatever you come across, building. So much so that even our skin corrodes, we corrode, our brain corrodes, everything corrodes. So it's a very generalized definition. Anything that is unwanted decay is corrosion. Something that I don't want to decay, and if it decays, it is corrosion. But if I am using something where I want that to decay to protect another thing, that's not corrosion. I'll during the day, during the talk, I'll be able to highlight that point. What is the cost? Because of the unawareness, or because of the lack of awareness of corrosion, how much do we end up paying extra? Now that's a very difficult thing to answer. A lot of surveys earlier on were carried out. Recent survey is now on, which will take another 1 year. But whatever survey is carried out, it is an indication that tells you about what is the direct loss because of corrosion. Indirect loss is very difficult to carry out. For example, now if this mic comes off and light goes off because of corrosion, and you are all sitting and we are all waiting for the light to come, if we waste about 15-20 minutes, half an hour, it is for everybody. Everybody would be losing that much time. This is indirect cost. Or if I go and call a mechanic to repair my car which has stopped working because of the corrosion problem, I go to the mechanic, come back, he replaces. All these parts are indirect loss of corrosion, which is not a part of this study, which cannot be estimated very precisely. So direct loss is very clearly one can probably come up with. And as I said, the recent survey is on. Now what is it? You might find it difficult to understand terms like GNP or GDP or how much is it. One will not be able to appreciate how much is it. But it's a staggering amount, let me tell you. I have found a very simple term. It is 10 units of currency per person per year. You go to US, multiply by 10, that many dollars they are losing because of lack of awareness. In my country, we are 1 billion people, 10 billion rupees is what we are losing because of lack of awareness. This is something which we can very conveniently save, which we are not doing. And you say, well, why, how can we save? Well, we are all scientific people, we all study the concepts, but unfortunately, when I tell you, you say, hey, was it this? It was so simple, I never knew about it, though I studied quite a lot of it. When I tell you that you have all studied about cathodes and anodes, or if I talk about this to anyone, one will say, yes, yes, I know what is it. When I talk about electrochemistry, you say, yes, we have studied, but we found it very difficult because of the long definitions, long derivations, things like Butler-Rosemore equation or Debye-Hückert derivation or Jerram-Pierre, and all these things we have studied. That's what makes you aversive towards this subject, because unfortunately, the way it should be taught, it is not done. Chemistry is a wonderful subject, but there are very few good teachers to inculcate interest in this. Had it been the other way around, the good percentage of teachers is barely 10%, I call it. I mean, some people may not like it, but that's the fact. If it is reversed, if 90% good teachers are there, you will find chemistry would be the subject to go in for. I had an excellent lecture by Professor Anand Sharma a long time back, wherein he highlighted what is chemistry without any slides, just excellent board lecture. So you'll find there is no area where chemistry is not used. But unfortunately, I'm going to tell you how simple it is. Well, I said any unwanted decay is corrosion, good enough, we have accepted that. How does it take place? Let me take a minute and explain all this. It can be studied in three ways. One is in the Earth's crust, very simple to study. And I'll also highlight that how things can be made difficult. Second is oxidation. Third is the electrochemical mechanism. Third one, when I explain, you will tell me, oh my God, it was very simple. I never realized this. I have studied it hundreds of times during my chemistry career. So, let's come to the first one. It can be studied in Earth's crust. You know, when you dig Earth, and if you are very careful in digging, you will be able to get a piece of, well, copper, maybe a piece of platinum, maybe a piece of gold, if you are lucky. Or, if you are very careful, however careful you are, however properly you dig, you will never be able to get a piece of iron, you will never be able to get a piece of aluminium, you will never get a piece of titanium. Why? Because they are all present in their stablest form in the Earth's crust. That is, in a combined form. And what do? We extract it, we call it rock, you know about it. We concentrate it, then we extract it by heating it with carbon, get the pure metal, and then that pure metal is not used as such. We convert it into an alloy, depending on what use we want. Maybe a body of car, or a hull of a ship, or a drain pipe, or whatever you want to use it for, it is converted into an alloy of the desired properties. Then what happens? Then that particular alloy, where the major metal is there, that would have a tendency to go back to the stablest form. And stablest form was where it came from. The one from where we extracted that. This is corrosion. Everything has a tendency to go back to the stablest form. To go back to where it came from. That goes with the human life also. That goes with the religious philosophy also. We are born, we are bubbling with energy, beautiful face, lovely skin, everybody feels like touching us. But gradually we grow old, we corrode, I'll say. I'm going to tell you, we corrode. And what do? To avoid corrosion, we apply a lot of moisturizers, oils, beauty products. Do you think we do it to beautify? No. It is to live longer. It is to protect ourselves. So when you do that, anybody who takes care looks younger for a longer time. And on the other side, who doesn't take care starts wrinkling very fast, and one doesn't feel like looking at the face of that person, because it is haggard, wrinkled face and dry face. You don't feel like even having a look at that. This is corruption. And gradually when we become old, 80 years, 90 years, ultimately we die. That is the stablest form. We are burnt or buried. That's about it. Wherever we came from, we have gone back to that. So this is the best way of studying what is corrosion. Anything and everything that comes goes back to the stablest form. And that means it corrodes. And everything has to corrode. Now what is going to be our duty? Our duty is going to be to make things, the life of things, longer. That's ultimate for everyone, for everything. Second part is going to be oxidation. Anything that you have will react with the atmosphere. Atmosphere means oxygen. And it will be converted to whatever product is going to be forming. If I take iron, it is going to be converted to iron oxide. The moment it gets changed to iron oxide, part of it is lost. Unless we use some energy, some method to recover that iron, it is lost for us. And it will have a tendency to go back from wherever it came back. So, in books, or teachers who would love to make things difficult for students would say, look, corrosion is irreversible metallurgy. They would use these words. Books is the irreversible metallurgy. What is irreversible metallurgy? The one we are explaining. But it makes things more difficult. If I say it goes to stainless form, this is simpler. So that is second part, that it is oxidation which explains what is corrosion. If it is if the building is there, it has to interact with the atmosphere, and gradually that atmosphere will wither that building out and will start getting disfigured after a while. Whatever the life is, 50 years, 100 years, 80 years, whatever. So, in order to improve that life, we whitewash it, we take care of that. This is primarily to avoid corrosion. So, oxidation. Now, if somebody says, well, the simple thing is, let's put things in vacuum. Well, if something is in vacuum, let me tell you, it will never corrode. Put it for 1,000 years, it will not corrode. But can you afford to do that? Can you put this building in vacuum? You can't. Anything that is there has to operate. If a ship is there, it has to operate. in the most hostile atmosphere, that is sea water. It is extremely corroded. But if somebody says, no, don't operate this, it won't corrode. But are we going to do that? It has to be operated. But we have to design methods by which the corrosion becomes minimized. So ultimate aim that we have is to minimize this devil called corrosion. And it's not difficult, let me tell you. When I'm going to give you a lot of examples, you'll be amazed that was it that simple? How is it that I was not adopting this in my own house? That is because you have been taught this subject, so-called chemistry, in a beautiful manner. And you depend upon a painter. You depend upon illiterate people rather than depending upon your own knowledge. You know, when somebody says, why does it happen? I say, you are LC chemistry, the other fellow is only 10th class master. The last part is electrochemical mechanism of corrosion. Now those who are averse to physical chemistry, when we start teaching physical to organic people, they start getting headache, unfortunately. And when we tell organic chemists, physical chemists, organic is very difficult. When we tell physical chemists, start writing these reactions, they will say, no, don't tell me all this. It's not my mind. So this is a useless artificial division that we have created. It is if you take the crux of that rather than going into nitty-gritties which are not needed. I always tell my friends, tell them what is Pythagoras theorem and tell them to apply that rather than getting into how was it proved. Alright, it is already proved. Why do you bother about it? Take this and go further. Same is the case here. If you people are not very clear about what electrochemical concepts are, I'm going to make things very simple and you'll be amazed, you'll be surprised, you'll be shocked. Let's see, I go to the third part because I'm going to extend that. Whatever I'm going to explain, you'll find that it is all related to this particular part. Now, if I take, if I take, let's say, copper sulfate solution, I need only 2 minutes, precisely 2 minutes to explain this. After that, I'm going to repeat a thing which will be getting into your head so badly that even if you wish to forget, you will never forget till you die. Let me tell you. I can assure you this. So, if you take copper sulfate and dip a copper wire or a rod, you know that there is some equilibrium which is established. Copper will go into copper solution as copper ions. Copper ions from there will go back to copper as neutral copper. This dynamic equilibrium which is established, we say it's the potential. There is some driving force which pushes it out, pushes the electrons out and the electrons get back. So this dynamic equilibrium, we call it half cell or half potential or potential of this half cell. Similarly, if I take another one, let's say zinc rod dipped in zinc sulfate solution, same kind of an equilibrium is going to be there also. That means this equilibrium is a kind of explanation of a driving force which enables you to understand how easily the electrons are going to be lost in the process. How easily they are lost is what we are learning from here. And if I connect these two by following usual things, salt bridge and all, forget about all this. Look at the salient feature of this. This is the one which loses electrons more conveniently as compared to copper. And these electrons they will travel through the external circuit, come here, and these electrons will be picked up by the copper ions which are present. It will become neutral copper, and it will ultimately be depositing on this rod here. Let's say I start with a very thin wire of copper, which is here, and I start with a thick block of zinc, which is there in this particular compartment. Now, over the next few hours, you will find that this would be losing electrons and it will be dissolving and getting into the solution as zinc ions. And this would be picking up electrons and would be depositing on this. Ultimately, after a while, you will find that this part would have got eaten away completely. Zinc would dissolve absolutely completely and copper wire, which we started, zinc wire, would become a thick rod. Because copper is depositing here. I think I lost my mic. Can you hear me, please?
Yeah.
Because it seems the mic is not very tight because of the weather.
Okay.
Yeah, that's okay. So what you find is, for comparison, we have evolved a standard cell, hydrogen standard cell, or saturated carbon, part of the electrochemistry. We say hydrogen cell under certain conditions, 25 degrees, 1 atmospheric, when it pass gas in 1 over HCl, over this, H going to H1, H1 going to go back. Under such conditions, the potential is zero. We call it zero. It is not zero in reality. Books will always write, it is zero. It is not. For arriving at some kind of uniformity, we call it, this is zero. Then similarly, saturated carbon electrode is there, which is more handy. That also gives you some potential. We say it's fixed potential of this much. Now whether I'm here or in USA or in England, these parameters are fixed. There is a standard. Otherwise, had I not done this, then somebody would have said, no, I'm going to call sodium as my standard. Somebody would have said, I'm going to call iron as my standard. And there would have been no uniformity throughout the world. Now we all know. And when we measure all these tendencies to lose electrons against some standard, and I organize them in increasing or decreasing order, this becomes our electrochemical series. And when I tell my friends what is electrochemical series, or I tell some teachers, they'll say, they'll start giving me an essay. 2-3 pages, 10 minutes, electrochemical series. Simple thing, the tendency to lose electrons, measured against some standard, and put in either increasing order or decreasing order is electrochemical series. Why am I telling you? It tells you about what is going to corrode and what is going to be protected. I hope I am clear on that, and we go further and come back to this. So rule of thumb which I said is anode corrodes and cathode gets protected. Such discrete cells are not there everywhere. You'd say, well, if this building is corroding, where is the anode, where is the cathode? I'm going to elaborate that also. Similarly, such discrete cells are not there, and there is no medium also, let me tell you. The wire connecting, I've explained, through which the electrons are going to travel. That is also not there. But what is there? The atmosphere, which are ions, which carry these ions from one to the other and lead to corrosion. Now, by the logic which I have given, the two metals in contact with one another would corrode. What about a single metal? By this logic, single metal should not be corroding. Well, that also corrodes. And by that logic, I have said everything corrodes. My skin corrodes, this building corrodes, desk corrodes, everything will be corroding. What is that? That is, if you look at the elements in the electrochemical series, you would find, this is the order, some of the metals are listed. Now if you connect any two, for example, you connect magnesium with iron, magnesium would be corroding. You connect aluminium with iron, aluminium will corrode. Connect iron with tin, iron would be corroding. When you connect the two, the higher one will have greater tendency to lose electrons, that means tendency to corrode, that means it will be anode. The lower down would be cathode, lesser tendency to lose electrons. That's it. So when two metals are in contact with one another, I can understand what is going to corrode and what is not going to be corroding. But what about a single metal? Well, that also corrodes. And when we look at that, that also corrodes. Why? You know, law of physics says 100% planarity is not possible. There will always be some deformation at the surface. So those deformations would lead to different extent of interaction with the atmosphere. Wherever there is more interaction and somewhere there is lesser interaction, that would set up a differential cell, a concentration cell. You have studied about that also. So one part would be anodic, the other part would be cathodic. The analogy is same. If I have different heights, water would flow from higher height to lower height. If I have different temperatures, from heat will flow from higher temperature to lower temperature. Similarly, if I have difference in potential, electrons would flow from one to the other. I've already elaborated that. Lesser tendency to lose electrons, it will push the electrons out. Similarly, when we have different extent of atmospheric interaction with anything, they will also have lesser extent and higher extent and things will start moving. That means one would be erotic, the other would be cathodic. I'll prove and I'll show you a lot of things here now. Now if I look at the plain pure iron here, this is something you can demonstrate. You can carry out yourself. Right now, had I got things, I would have probably set up this experiment here only. And by the time I would have finished my lecture, this would have been ready to be seen by everybody. You take a pure piece of iron here, and as I said, it is not 100% planar. Put a drop of water which will have sodium chloride, phenolphthalein and K3FeCl6. One drop having all these things, put it here, the drop would look like this. I have drawn it with hand, but I would have probably carried out a picture also, which I could not. I thought this lecture is going to be for this audience. So if you look at it, you look at the center. Center, lesser air would reach the surface. On the sides of the drop, more air would be able to reach the surface. That means here is the concentration cell. This part where lesser air is reaching would be anode. That means iron would start coming into solution as ferrous ions. And here we have hydroxyl and all other ions also. So when ferrous comes out, K3FeCl6 is one of the indicators, external indicators that we use for titration. So ferrous with K3FeCl6 will give you bluish color. So at the center, this is the top elevation, it will give you bluish color. Hydroxyl ions are there because it is water that you have taken. Phenolphthalein in hydroxyl's presence will give you pink color. And at the periphery of the drop, you will find pinkish color. Within 20 minutes, beautifully the colors come. Now all negative ions will move towards anode, all positive ions will move towards cathode. They will start moving in the opposite direction and you will find they will meet the somewhere at the juncture. Ferrous hydroxyl. Ferric also will be formed because of the aerial oxidation in no time. Ferric hydroxide, ferric oxide, ferrous-ferric oxide. There are about 20 different kinds of oxides and hydroxides which would be meeting and a precipitate is formed, which is a combination of all these 20 oxides and hydroxide, which is called rust. It is brownish, deep brownish in color. You have seen it all over your nuts, bolts, houses. Everywhere you will find this brown color, which is the biggest enemy of the humankind, comes. And you will find that this is formed at the center, here at the juncture. So this brown color is called rust. That is why when it is iron which is getting corroded, we all say it is getting rusted. Anything else that we have, we will say it is getting corroded. My mind gets corroded. We will put it that way. But loosely we say, oh, he doesn't do very well, his mind is rusted. You know, this wall is rusted. It's not. Iron is the only one which rusts because the compound which is formed is called rusting. That's about it. Nothing else I need to explain. At the end, once again, anode corrodes and cathode gets protected. Anodic areas will always develop because of the differential available at the surface. Our tendency is to avoid the setting up of anodic and cathodic areas. That is the reason that anything that you come across in the work which you are using would be always planar. We will have a tendency to make everything as plain as possible because there the tendency of setting up of anodic and cathodic areas are minimized. Now to give you an example, you look at things around you. The floor I am standing on is very plain. The table Dr. Raval is sitting on is extremely plain. Your chair which you are sitting is very plain. Floor is plain. Cameras are plain. You tell me any surface which is rough. Now go across. If it is winter season and you have not applied any moisturizer on your lips, it will become rough. You know, wavery, and that roughness is corrosion. It becomes so dry that you don't even feel like laughing. You find it very difficult to talk. So what do? You start applying oil and it becomes normal. And when it is normal, you move your finger, it will be very plain. But if it is very dry, it will be, you can feel the roughness. Roughness on your skin, if it is there, you will see how bad it looks. But when you apply moisturizer, it becomes very plain. So idea is to avoid this as far as possible. Now let's come down to some of the things which are going to prove what I've said. Next 5 minutes, all these examples. You know, I did say, when you ask engineers why the aluminium strip was there around buses, on all vehicles, they say it's for the aesthetic sense. It makes the vehicle very beautiful. And on top of it, there's a rubber roller, thick roller that runs around. There's a, it looks better, it keeps the aluminium strip in place. It's not that. It is to avoid the grazing collisions which the vehicle will have, and it will prevent any kinks or marks that will come on the vehicle. Now, the purpose of these anodic vehicles, anodes, aluminium strip on the vehicle is that this provides a sacrificial anode on the body. Body is made up of steel. I did show you that electrochemical series, aluminium is higher up, steel is lower down. So it is aluminium that will be corroding. So aluminium would be corroding, and the whole body will be getting protected. Carry out a comparison. When you go after this lecture out on the road, you look at the roadways buses. Roadways buses will be rattling. They will look as if they are 10 years old, though in reality it may be 6 months old. And you look at, they will not have these aluminium strips intact. Look at the tourist buses. They are owned by a private person. He will take all kinds of care. These aluminium strips will be beautifully intact. And the bus would look, even 10-year bus would look as if it is as new as 1 year old. That is because the corrosion of the main body is avoided. But we don't bother about it. We have a national scooter called Bajaj, isn't it? There also we used to have aluminium strips. Some of the vehicles which are now coming, Kinetic, Honda or whatever, they don't have this, they are under the body. Ambassador cars, my old friend who was sitting here, would bear me out, they used to have an aluminium strip on the body, Ambassadors and Fiats. But the modern cars that we have, they don't have it, they have it under the vehicle. One. And then their paint, you would have heard this or you would have read it somewhere in the advertisements, the paint is powder coated vacuum painted. Repeatedly they write, this washing machine is going to last 20 years because it is powder coated vacuum painted. Powder coated means they do that nano particles coating on this. It has large surface area, takes up all the water, and then it is vacuum painted. When it is vacuum painted, there is no differential in air entrapment under the paint. Uniform air entrapment. If it is not, then you will find wherever there is more or wherever there is less, that differential will be there, and an anodic part will spoil the paint. It will swell up, it will blister off, and you touch, it will go, and it will start looking very bad. So when we used to have this Bajaj scooter, you bring it out, it used to be very good. After 6 months, it will start rattling. And our tendency used to be, what is it that rattles? We used to touch, and when the moment you touch that paint, the aluminium strip, the rattling will stop. So instead of tightening it, what we were doing is we would just take it out and throw it off. The moment you do this, the death knell is there. Then the paint will start coming off, it will start getting corroded very fast because there is no anode on that. And one-year-old scooter will look like 10-year-old. That's the story. And you are aware of it, but we have never bothered about this. I think I'll give you a related example also. We all buy new cars. We all would have bought. All these paints of the new cars is this powder-coated vacuum painted. That's why they are better lasting. We all buy the new cars. What do we do? The first thing that we do, unfortunately, is, we take it to the temple or Gurdwara or church or whatever to pray that Almighty, let it run very smoothly. Second thing you do is from there, now I'll say, unfortunately, you take it to the accessory shop. Accessory shop, brand new car, where is the purpose? The purpose is you tell you, put a speaker here, 200 watts, 50 watt speaker here. It's a small volume. Do you need 200 wattage? Even 5 watt speaker is going to be so terrible that you can't even hear. But then we have a bad habit. That's one. And to put those speakers, what he does is he drills a hole to put this tightly. The moment that hole is drilled, you have cut the paint. That powder coated, vacuum painted paint is cut by you and the corrosion will stop there. You can't avoid it. and when the speaker speaks from top, underneath lesser air will reach, but it will definitely reach, and it will start corroding, and your car, you will find after 1-2 years, and this will. All of you, I'm saying, barring one or two, you tell them to put brand new seat covers, costing 4,000 rupees, 3,000 rupees. Where is the necessity for this? You will say, oh sir, this seat cover will not go dirty, it will not become bad. Brand new car, it is so clean. How will it go dirty? Allow it to become dirty for 4-5 years, then put seat covers. But you will do it because the accessory owner advises you. What are you doing? The seat covers, original seat covers, are made up of polymeric material. When you put cover, fixed covers, they cut off the air supply, and the polymeric material underneath would become very hard, anodic areas. So hard, you take out these covers after 6 months. I'm telling you, those original covers would crack off. They crack. The life, which would have been 10 years old, 10 years, now will be, you have reduced it to 4 months. And whom? Has anybody seen those sheets because you have put the covers? Where is the necessity? But that's, now you keep on calculating how much money you are saving. I said 30%, but it will ultimately end up to be much more.
Sir, please conclude in 5 minutes.
Yeah, you give me 5 minutes, otherwise it will not be useful. Magnesium, why have they put it on water pipes? Previously, water pipes used to burst in hilly areas particularly because of the extension of water. And water goes through the buried areas also. It leaks because of corrosion, and it used to crack because of the extension of the water. Nowadays we don't. We wrap magnesium wires on the water in hilly terrain particularly, and magnesium wire being anodic would crack, would corrode, and will replace those periodically, and the things have become very simple. Similarly, we have magic metal which you would have bought in the fairs. They say it is 400 rupees, buy magic metal, and you can use it for cleaning silver and gold jewelry and cutlery. It is nothing but a lump of magnesium or aluminium. You all have aluminium in your house, and along with the magic metal, they give you some powdery material that is sodium carbonate. So you take aluminium utensil, add some sodium carbonate, and put the cutlery that you need to clean, silver sulfide. Silver cutlery becomes darker because of silver sulfide formation. And you put it, there is a mild current which is generated, it reduces silver sulfide to silver. And it is clean. But we pay unnecessary lot of money to the persons for no reasons. So it doesn't cost anything. Then zinc coating is the one. You know, we buy coolers in our houses. This is normal material will corrode very fast. But if you take galvanized cooler, zinc is coated, it is zinc which will be corroding, and the body will be protected. Cost difference will not be much. And if you have bought and it is not galvanized, please buy zinc powder from the market, costing about 25 rupees a kilo. Make a paste and put it loosely on the cooler's body. You will find only zinc will become powdery after about 6-8 months. Nothing will go wrong with this, and your cooler will be protected. Tin foot is another thing I thought I'll tell you, and after that I'll give you 2 more examples and I'll wind up. We use tin foot. Is it made up of tin? It is not. It is made up of steel again, but there is a tin coating inside. Tin is lower down, zinc, iron is higher up. If there is a crack and corrosion starts, it will be iron which will come into your food, and iron is one of the minerals we require. But if you have to lengthen the life of this container, you will say we should have zinc coating, because zinc is higher up. If zinc coating is there, then in the food, it will be zinc which will come into your food. And if zinc comes in, instead of becoming healthier, it's not possible, and that steel is the one which is being used for airports and other buildings, they will be absolutely corrosion free. We paint our buildings. You also do this. I'm just winding up in a minute or so because I thought whatever I have, I must give it to you. Since I've come all the way and I've wasted so much money on my friend Rahul's. You know, last you paint the house. We will always settle with the painter, look, I'm going to pay you this much. you know, you make sure that the earlier coat is completely removed. It is not done in most of the houses. They just loosely do that and then repaint it. Whatever has remained would have lesser air underneath, and that would be anodic, and you will find that paint would start coming off in about 6 to 10 months period, and it will blister off. If you remove it completely, employ a labor, put another 300 rupees, and probably you will find that paint will be lasting 10 times the period which you would have otherwise bought. So you can imagine how much saving you can do that. So I have loosely told you this. This is 30% is my guess, but if you actually measure, it will be much more than that. And if some of the youngsters can get into or can get inculcated into the research in corrosion, you can get wonderful publications without much of an effort. It's simple to carry out, easy to study, very convenient to understand, and if you get some good papers immediately, you can go abroad, get advancement and come back and start serving your country. This would be a much better thing to do. Taj Mahal is what all of us have seen. Our friends would have seen it in good old days. It used to be pure white. Now it is becoming pale yellow. Because, you know, you would have read it in the papers, it is vehicular pollution. It is because of the leather industry. So they have stopped leather industry, they have stopped vehicles coming near the car. It is not so. It is rubbish. The major cause of pollution to Taj is the setting up of Mathura refinery. It is such a huge refinery. I don't understand what is the purpose of that refinery. Oil comes from Assam. It is refined there, then it is sent back. Why not set it somewhere which is more convenient? Air goes from Delhi, Agra, and the Delhi, Mathura, Agra. If somebody says, I'm going to reverse the flow of air, he's not almighty. So it will stay that way, and the CO2 and SO2 from Mathura flows to that side, and Taj is on the bank of a river. So the moisture there sets up acidic environment around carbonic acid, sulfurous acid, and very gradually, in decades, Taj is getting corroded. This problem they had in Manchester, they sorted it out. We also suggested Taj requires a polymeric coating now if you have to protect it. But if you coat, it is going to not give you that kind of a luster during full moonlight. That's the thing people are debating whether to do it or not. But if you now go and see Taj, it is already pale yellow. If some of you have not seen, it is better to see before it gets corroded and becomes absolutely yellowish. And it will no longer be one of the wonders in the next decade, probably. That is how I predict. I wrote an article, I got threats from UP government, stop doing this. Stop doing this, otherwise then there are green dots. But one advantage in our profession is we don't bother. Whatever you feel like, we do tell the people. And that is one of the things I thought I would mention. I enjoyed giving my talk. If you have any questions, I'll be happy. One more thing I can tell you. You all use utensils for cooking in your residences. You use steel utensils. Please don't do this. Steel utensils can be always used for storing. Do not boil anything in that. Over the years, if you use that, it is extremely harmful. Use aluminium utensils. Previously, it used to be only aluminium utensils. I didn't have the time to tell you. These days, we use anodized aluminium utensils. It is protect corrosion-free area where it is anodized. Anodic protection, it is called. And it is so durable that you can probably, for generations, you'll find it won't corrode. Have you ever seen any pressure cooker developing holes or getting deformed? Never. It might start leaking, that's it. But the body doesn't decay. So use that, it is safest. Because our Indian style is we make a lot of masalas, and when we add ghee in that, we think it is vitamin which we are adding, but vitamin ki jo char generation hum log destroy kar dete hain banane mein. So use aluminium, anodized aluminium utensils, they are safest for your health, cheaper, one-tenth of the cost of steel that you spend on, and whatever way you cook, whether it is acidic, basic, whatever, it will be safest, food will not go bad in that, and that's it. Thank you so very much. If you are right, these are some of the inhibitors we have been using. And I just want to show you one slide. These are the, if you can get this switched off, probably they'll be able to appreciate this. You know, this is weight loss that I was telling you, you can initiate yourself. See this, it is absolutely black. This is brass in seawater. In 3 days it is corroding like this. And look at this, where we added some inhibitor. This is for benzohydrochromic acid as inhibitor. See how shiny it is without any corrosion. And I never had any intention to show you all this. I want to show you the last slide. If you can change it from there. Last slide, hello?
Last slide.
Okay, Rahul sir, as chairman, will always get annoyed. Go to the last slide, very last slide. Yeah. This is the building where I come from. Or, Kyongya. You know, the building that I've shown, it has 21 exits. And University of Delhi has 85 affiliated colleges. And since it is in Delhi, every student and every teacher has a member of parliament in their pocket. They think they are the center of power. And there are a lot of agitation. We encourage democratic systems. So whenever there is any agitation, the persons, officers of the university would slip away through one of the exits, and students will be agitating. 21 exits, nobody would remember through which side they have gone. I know that, because I've acted as a proctor, and we are having collaboration with Italy, so this is one of the things. This is my research group with some of the Italians. That's it. Thank you so very much. No more. I would appreciate if you have any questions. And a stage when you don't get any questions, there are two possibilities. One, everything has been very clear, so no question. The other is, nothing is clear. So, I am optimistic. I thought everything is very clear.
You have explained the phenomena in a very lucid and very simple manner. So I think everything is very clear. I thank Professor Gurmit Singh for very informative talk. And he has cited very simple examples to explain the phenomena of corrosion.
Students, please be seated. Please be seated. Only for 5 minutes. Please be seated.
Once again, I thank Dr. Gurmit Singh and Dr. D.S. Shankarli for coming down to Anand for a long way from Mumbai and Delhi. Thank you once again. Thank you, sir.
Now, I would like to call Dr. Darshan Patel sir to present a memento to Professor Gurmit Singh sir.